Friends, so far we discussed about the medieval India. We have discussed about the travelers who visited and during the period of medieval India. We have also read about the Mughal rulers, their chronicles. So these topics we have covered in second book, and the second book is related to the medieval history of India. Now we are going to start the third book. And this book deals with the modern India. So we will begin by the first chapter of the third book, that is the colonialism and the countryside. So today we will read about what was the impact of the Britishers' arrival in India, especially in the rural India. What was the result of this arrival of the foreign rulers in India? And what were the policies of the Britishers who had affected the peasants in the rural India at that time? That we are going to discuss over here. What changes they have brought in the revenue system? So all these things will be discussed in the chapter Colonialism and the Countryside. Students, we are going to start the next chapter, that is the Colonialism and the Countryside. Here colonialism refers to the British rule which was started in India at that time, and the countryside refers to the rural areas of that time. And we will discuss about the effect of the policies which were made by the Britishers upon these country people or the peasants of that time. So you can see from the image also, this is an image of rural area where peasants are shown. So we are going to study about the history of the peasantry of that time. And we are going to study this history with the help of the official archives, means the official records which are preserved at that time and which are still available. With the help of these official records, we are coming to know about that period, and that will be discussed in this chapter. So now we will discuss about the sources. What are the sources available for that period? First of all, the revenue record which was prepared by the company at that time, they are still available. With the help of these records, we have come to know about the period of that time and the people of that time, the community of that time. The survey which were conducted by the Britishers at that time, they are also safe. So with the help of these surveys, we have come to know about that period. Then journals which used to be published at that time, and the accounts which were left by the surveyors as well as the travelers who used to visit India at that time. Then the reports produced by the inquiry commission. Since there were many policies of the Britishers which used to be against the peasants, so the peasants generally used to revolt against the Britishers. So the Britishers generally used to set up an inquiry commission, and that inquiry commission used to make a detailed report of the incident of that time. So with the help of that detailed record, we have come to know about the period and the people of that time. Now, first of all, we will discuss about the Bengals and the Zamindars. So why we have started our chapter with the Bengal? Because when the Britishers came to India, they set up their rule firstly in Bengal. Thereafter, they set up their rule in the rest of India, and they started their rule in Bengal after the Battle of Plassey, that was 1657. Thereafter, there was another battle, that was the Battle of Buxar, and after the Battle of Buxar, they got the Diwani of the area of the Bengal, and from there, they started collecting the revenue, and they adopted a new policy to collect the revenue. So that we are going to study from the revenue record of Bengal of that time. So we are going to start our chapter from the Bengal itself. There used to be the Zamindari system at that time in Bengal. So we are also going to study about the Zamindars of Bengal of that time. So the chapter begins with the auction which was held at Burdwan. Burdwan is a district in Bengal. So at that time in Bengal, 75% Zamindari used to be sold by the company. They were auctioned by the company because the Zamindars were not able to pay the revenue to the company. As a result, their Zamindari used to be sold. And in that kind of auction, numerous purchasers used to come, as these numerous purchasers also came in the auction of Burdwan at that time, and they wanted to purchase the land. And generally, the estate used to be given to the highest bidder, who used to pay the highest amount of that land. In an auction, he was given the piece of that land, the zamindari of that area, but there was a twist in the tale. Means the purchasers who used to be there, who wanted to purchase the land, generally they used to be the servant of the zamindar. And the zamindar was the same zamindar whose land used to be auctioned in these kind of auctions. So generally the zamindar used to retain the control of their land again with the help of their servants and agents, who used to be the agent of the zamindar and who used to participate in that auction. So this was a way to retain the zamindari, and in this way the zamindar used to escape to pay the revenue to the company. So this kind of sale used to be the fictitious sale. So over 95% of the sale which was done by the company at that time in Bengal used to be fictitious sale, because generally the zamindar could not be displaced by the company, because the zamindar used to send their own men in the auction and they again used to purchase the same land for the zamindar in the less prices than the revenue. So these kind of auctions used to be there in Bengal. You can see that this is the zamindar Mehtab Jan, who used to be the zamindar of Burdwan at that time, and this is the palace or the mahal of that zamindar where he used to reside. So he used to live a very luxurious life and he was having a grand place and he was having under control a large estate of the land from where he used to collect the revenue. So the zamindars used to be a very powerful figure in the Bengal. Now, why they were not able to pay the revenue? The zamindars used to be very rich, but still they were not able to pay the revenue. So what were the causes that we are going to discuss over here? By 1770, the rural economy in Bengal was in crisis with the recurrent famine and declining agricultural prices. So that was the circumstances under which the zamindars were not able to pay the revenue, because the rural economy of the Bengal was in crisis due to the famine and declining prices of the agricultural products. Officials felt that agriculture, trade and the revenue resources of the state could be developed by encouraging investment in the agriculture. So this was the thinking of the British officials, that the agriculture in Bengal is very backward and that can be developed only with the help of encouraging the investment in the agriculture. And how they can invest the money in the agriculture when they will get more profit in the agriculture? So when the peasants will have a better profit or zamindars will have a better profit, then only they will be able to invest their money in the land, and in this way they can get the higher output from the agriculture, and that can be the only way through which the agricultural development can be done. So this was the thinking of the officials of the British India at that time. This could be done by securing rights. So the zamindars were not the permanent owner of the land at that time, but if they would be made the permanent owner of the land at that time by fixing the permanent rate of the revenue, they will be able to have more saving in their hand, and with the help of that saving they will be able to invest more money in the development of agriculture, and in this way they can develop their agricultural output, or they can increase the agricultural output. Company will look forward for a regular flow of revenue. By fixing the permanent rate of revenue, the company will be able to get the regular revenue from the peasant or the zamindar, because they did not to do survey again and again, they did not to contact to the zamindar again and again. Once they have fixed the land revenue, they will get it regularly from the zamindar. So that was the thinking of the company at that time. And this would lead to the emergence of yeoman farmer. They believed that in this way the farmers will be there and they will be the rich landowners, and they will invest the capital in the improvement of agriculture, and the agriculture will be improved in this way. Now, how did this happen? So we will come to know that the situation in Bengal was not good, but there must be some reason. So we will read the main cause of this kind of the situation, and that we will come to know from the official record, and from there we came to know about the permanent settlement. So what was the permanent settlement? So this was a policy which was implemented in 1793 by the company, and the permanent settlement was introduced in India by Charles Cornwallis. He used to be the Governor General of India at that time. So Charles Cornwallis earlier used to be an American Civil War of Independence, and in that he was from the side of the Britishers who used to fight against the 13 colonies of the USA. But there he got a defeat, and after that he came to Britain, and from there he was sent to India as the Governor General. So he remained in that position for many years, and he was sent twice in India in the capacity of the Governor General. So when he came first time in India, he introduced permanent settlement. And Charles Cornwallis is also known for various other policies which he implemented in India. First of all, he is called as the father of civil service in India. And many other administrative reforms were also done by the Charles Cornwallis. So the main thing which Charles Cornwallis did in India, that was the permanent settlement. So permanent settlement was a kind of the revenue policy which was introduced by him. The permanent settlement was made with the Rajas and the Talukdar. So this was a treaty generally which was made with the Rajas and the Talukdars of that time. Rajas and Talukdars used to be the most powerful figure in Bengal at that time, and they used to be the most influential people in Bengal at that time. They were now classified as the Zamindars, and they had to pay the revenue demand that was fixed in perpetuity. Means the land which they were having under their control, according to that land, they were asked to deposit a fixed amount of the revenue to the company every year. The company fixed the total demand over the entire estate whose revenue the zamindar contracted to pay. He was expected to pay the company regularly, failing which his estate could be auctioned. So that was the main reason. They were asked to deposit the fixed amount of money on a particular day by the sunset. And before the sunset, if he is able to pay that revenue, then the zamindari would remain again in the control of the same zamindar. Otherwise, his estate could be auctioned by the company in a public auction where everybody was free to purchase the land. So that kind of system was adopted in India under the policy of permanent settlement, and it was introduced by Charles Cornwallis. Now the question comes, why zamindars defaulted on the payment? Why there was a need to sell the zamindari of a zamindar when he used to be so rich? So there may be some reason, or there may be some faults in the permanent policy of revenue. As a result, zamindar was not able to pay the revenue in time. So what were those faults that we are going to discuss over here? First reason is that the initial demand of the revenue was very high. So the company fixed the revenue for a long period of time. So the company thought about its anticipated loss with the passage of time. The company believed that with the passage of time, when the prices of the crop will remain high, will become high with the passage of time, because it will not remain the same lower price as it is at that time. So the company cannot change its policy to get more revenue from the peasant, because it will be fixed for a long period of time. As a result, company thought about that anticipated loss in the future. So the company already kept the demand of the revenue very high, and it was not within the limit of the poor peasant to pay that high demand of the revenue. Second is that this high demand was imposed in 1790. So 1790 was the period when this high demand of the revenue was fixed, and at that time the agriculture was already in the crisis, because the prices depressed and it was very difficult for the royal to pay the revenue dues to the zamindar at that time. If the zamindar could not collect the rent, then how the zamindar would be able to pay the revenue to the company? Because zamindar used to collect the revenue from the peasants, and if peasants were not in a good condition, they were not able to pay the revenue to the zamindar. How it can be possible for the zamindar to collect the revenue from the peasant in that situation and pay it to the company? So that was a problem. The third problem was that the revenue was invariably regardless of the harvest. Means whether the harvest is good or bad, it was not having any concern with the revenue. The revenue used to remain the same. But earlier what used to be there, if the harvest is not good, generally the revenue of the farmer used to be remitted by the ruler of the Bengal at that time. But company did not continue this policy. They fixed it for all time, whether the crop is good or bad. And generally, that was the time when there used to be a lot of famine and drought like situation in Bengal. So the peasants were not able to pay the revenue to the company. And the third most important policy was the sunset law, that the zamindar was supposed to submit the payment by the sunset of that particular date. If he was not able to pay the revenue to the company by the sunset of that particular date, his zamindari generally used to be auctioned. So that was the policy of the company. As a result, zamindar generally used to default the payment. And the fourth one is that the permanent settlement initially limited the power of the zamindar. The zamindar used to be very powerful during the rule of the Nawab of Bengal, but now the zamindar lost their power. As a result, they were not able to exercise any kind of power upon the peasant because they became powerless. Earlier, zamindar used to have kacharis. They were also working as the judge, and where they used to resolve the conflict among the peasants, and they were also having their own police. With the help of that, they could force the peasant to pay the revenue. But now these powers were not given to the zamindar, rather they were limited to the company's officials only. So the zamindar could not exercise any kind of harsh method to get the revenue from the peasant. As a result, the riot means the peasant, they were not able to pay the revenue to the zamindar, and zamindar was also not able to pay the revenue to the company. So that was also an important cause why the zamindars had defaulted on the payment to the company. Now, the company had recognized the zamindar as an important figure, but it also wanted to control and regulate the zamindar, because zamindar used to be very powerful and generally they were not able to exercise power upon the zamindar. So they wanted to reduce the power of the zamindar. So company wanted to make zamindar weaker than he used to be powerful in the past, and they wanted to subdue the authority and restrict their autonomy. Zamindar used to be a kind of autonomous ruler of his land or his area during the rule of the Nawab, but the company could not tolerate this power. As a result, they wanted to subdue the authority of the zamindar. They wanted to make him weaker than the past. The zamindar troops were disbanded. Zamindars were also having troops, and these troops generally used to help the Nawab at the time of battle. So that was disbanded because the company thought that it could be dangerous for the company itself in the future. So they disbanded the troops of the zamindar. Custom duties which the zamindar used to take from the traders and other people, that was abolished. And their kachari, it was a kind of court where zamindar used to work as the judge and he used to resolve the conflict among the peasants, that was also disbanded, or that was also abolished by the company. And it was also brought under the supervision of the collector. So the collector used to be more powerful in a district than the zamindar, and zamindar used to be under the supervision of that collector, which was appointed by the company. In this way, we can see that the company tried their level best to reduce the power of the zamindar. As a result, the zamindar lost their power to organize local justice, which he used to organize in the kacharis, and he could not also use the local police because his troops were also disbanded. So zamindar became very powerless, and when zamindar became powerless, so this opportunity was used by the riots, and they were not paying the revenue in time to the zamindar. Now, talukdars were also there, and it was a term which was used at that time. one who holds the taluk. Taluk is a kind of tehsil, means a large area under a district used to be under the control of the talukdar. Or a connection, taluk came to refer to the territorial unit. So talukdar were also like the zamindars, but they were mainly found in UP, not in Bengal. And in UP, the revenue system which was introduced later on, in that the talukdar used to be as important as the zamindars used to be there in the Bengal. Now, rent collection became a perennial problem for the company as well as for the zamindar. So zamindar as well as the company were not able to collect the rent because of the problems which we have discussed earlier. Sometimes bad harvest, that I told you that famine like situations also used to be there, and sometimes there used to be very low prices, and because of that the zamindars were not getting the revenue from the riots, because riots felt it very difficult to pay the revenue to the zamindar in time in that condition. And sometimes riots deliberately delayed the payment, and they were not giving the payment in time to the zamindar because they wanted to see the zamindar in the trouble. And generally they were asked, or they were mobilized, or they were instigated not to pay the payment to the zamindar in time by another rich peasant generally who used to be there in the rural India at that time, and that was called as the Jotdar. So Jotdar, who was also a powerful peasant of a rural area, and generally he used to reside with the peasant, and he was also very rich, but he was not that rich as the zamindar used to be, but still he was also a challenge to the zamindar, and he generally used to mobilize the peasant against the zamindar, and he used to ask them not to pay the revenue to the zamindar because he wanted to see the zamindar in trouble. And zamindars could not prosecute the defaulter, especially the jotdars could not be prosecuted by the zamindar, and if he tries to prosecute the zamindar jotdar, and he when he was imprisoned by the zamindar, generally the jotdar used to go to the police station, and he generally used to lodge the FIR against the zamindar, and zamindar generally was punished for that. So now he could not exercise his power upon the jotdar as well as the rayots, who were deliberately delaying the payment. In this way we can see that the zamindar was trapped by the company, and as a result he was not able to pay the revenue in time. Now comes the rise of jotdar. So we discussed about the jotdar, that he used to be very powerful in the rural areas of the Bengal, and generally he used to be the challenge to the zamindar himself. So first of all, he used to be a very powerful figure in the village, and he was also controlled the trade of the village, and he was also acting as the money lender. The peasants used to take money from him at the time of crisis, and he used to help the peasant. So generally the peasants used to remain under the influence of the jotdar, and he was the person who used to instigate the peasants for deliberately delaying the payment to the zamindar because he wanted to see the zamindar in trouble. And he was also the commanding figure in the village, and upon whose instigation the peasants could be mobilized. So he was a very influential person in the rural areas of Bengal at that time. A large part of their land was cultivated through the sharecroppers. So there used to be the fellow peasants who used to be worker of the jotdar, and they used to work as the sharecroppers, and they used to work as the adhyar or the barkadars. It means some portion of the crops used to be taken by these workers, and rest of the portion of the crop used to be given to the jotdar. So jotdar was a person who used to give employment to a large number of people in the rural India at that time, and zamindar used to purchase the crops of the fellow peasants also, and the sharecroppers also used to bring their own clothes. They used to labor in the field of the jotdar, and they used to hand it over half of the production to the jotdar. So jotdar used to be very powerful because many peasants used to be the sharecropper of the jotdar, and they used to depend upon the jotdar for their survival. So they could not resist the effort of the jotdar. The produce of the jotdar after the harvest was given to the Jodhar and half of the portion was kept by the sharecroppers. And there used to be the long judicial process. If suppose there is a dispute between the Jodhar and the Zamindar, so Zamindar used to file a suit against the Jodhar, and that used to be a long judicial process. As a result, the Zamindar was not able to punish the Jodhar for instigating the peasants against him. And he generally resisting the effort of the Zamindar in collecting the revenue. So he used to resist the effort of the Zamindar to collect the revenue from the fellow peasant. And he used to mobilize the fellow peasant against the Zamindar. One more important thing was that the Zamindar, who used to be very rich, but he generally used to live in the cities. But the Jodhar used to remain along with the villagers. So he was having a better contact with the villagers than the Zamindar. Now you can see that this is a village scene of Bengal, which was painted by the George Chinnery. And in this you can see that there is an image, and this is the image of a house, and the house is of a Jodhar. So Jodhar was having a bigger house than the fellow peasants in the rural area. You can see that this is a pakka house which is of Jodhar, and these are the huts which were of the fellow peasants. So he was a commanding figure in the village, and generally he was also acting as the mandal or the sarpanch in the village. Now we have seen that the condition of the zamindar was not good. The rules of the company were also like that. They wanted to make him weaker, and the peasants were also not supporting him. The Jodhar was also hatching plan against the zamindar. So zamindar was trapped from all sides by the company as well as the fellow peasants. So how he found out the ways to survive in that condition? So here we are going to discuss about that. So we will discuss about the resistance which was made by the zamindars at that time. First of all, the transfer of zamindari to the near and dear ones. The first thing which he used to do, that he used to transfer his zamindari to his near and dear ones, and generally this transfer was made to the ladies, because at that time there was a rule of the company that any property which used to be named after a lady or which was under the control of a lady, that could not be auctioned. So in this way, zamindar was deliberately not paying the revenue, and for saving his land, he generally used to transfer his property to the mother, wife or any other lady of the family. So unpaid balance were allowed to accumulate. So this was also done deliberately by the zamindar. When there used to be a large amount of sum which used to be accumulated at that time, the fictitious sales were also organized. So the sale which was organized by the company to auction the zamindari of that zamindar. In that sale, the zamindar used to sell and send his own servants and the fellow peasants to purchase the land back for him, as we have discussed in the auction of Burdwan. In this way, they used to purchase the property of the zamindar, but generally the purchaser never returned back to get the control of that land from the company, and in this way the purchaser used to be fictitious, and this kind of purchase was called as the Benami purchase. So what is Benami purchase? Here it is also given, literally anonymous. It means where the purchaser used to be anonymous, and generally they used to remain anonymous because they were not the real purchaser. The real purchaser used to be the zamindar, because they were purchasing the land on the behalf of that zamindar only, and he generally used to remain hidden because the zamindari was also of the same zamindar who used to be the purchaser. Then riots registered the entry of the outsider. If somehow the sale was not fictitious and somebody was able to purchase that zamindari, then he had to go there to control or to get that hold of the land. But generally his efforts were registered by the riots who used to be there, because they used to be very loyal to the existing zamindar, and they did not allow anybody from outside to get the control of that land. And generally, in that case, the zamindar used to send the lathiya, and they used to beat the outsiders, and they used to threaten him not to enter into the farm, which was generally controlled by the zamindar. By the beginning of the 19th century, the depression of the price was over. Means the price, which used to be very low at that time, now that period was over. And the prices of the crop was improved considerably. As a result, now revenue payment was not a problem. And meanwhile, company felt that the revenue rate is very high. So they also relaxed the revenue rate and it was made flexible. So now the problem of the revenue payment was not there and it was sorted out by the zamindar and the company. Now zamindar finally got hold of his property again. But they finally collapsed and during the Great Depression, which came in 1930, by that time they finally collapsed because of the Great Depression. But before that, the zamindar remained in a powerful position because they have found out the ways and means through which they can protect their land and the property. Now, fifth report. So, what was the fifth report? As its name indicates, it was a report which was 5th in series, and at that time there were various reports which were published by the company because company wanted to keep an eye on the affair of the company's administrative officers, and British Parliament was also having an eye upon the company's affair in India. So this was also a report which was submitted to the British Parliament on the company's affair in India in 1813. So, and this report, because was in series and this was 5th in series, that's why it is also called as the 5th report. And it was having 1002 pages, of which over 800 pages were appendices that reproduced petitions of the zamindars and the rivals. So mainly this report contained the petitions or the appeals which were made by the zamindars and the rivals to the company, and generally these used to be for the relaxation of the revenue prices. And apart from that, there was also reports of the collectors for different districts at that time, and there used to be statistical tables on revenue returns. Opposition of the monopoly. So this was hotly debated in the British Parliament, and there used to be opponent of the company's monopoly over India because it was also a private company. British East India Company was a private company, but it was given the monopoly under the Charter of 1600, and it was given the monopoly by the Queen of the England. But there were many other private companies, they also wanted to get profit from the trade with India, so they opposed this decision of the government, and they opposed the monopoly of the East India Company upon India's trade. And as a result, they generally used to accuse the company for their misrule and maladministration, and this was highlighted also in the fifth report. So the fifth report became a very controversial report, and with the help of this report, the opponents of the British East India Company became very active. And they also pressurized the government to abolish the Charter Act, which was given to the company a monopoly with India's trade in 1600. Appointments of the inquiry committee was also made at that time, and the reports were also published, and the reports cannot be accepted uncritically. So whatever is written in the fifth report, critics believed that everything is exaggerated, because there was also a concept to exaggerate these things because they wanted to end the company's rule in India. As a result, in the fifth report also the statistical data and other things were also exaggerated deliberately so that they can end the monopoly of the British East India Company upon India. And this fifth report was having a very long consequences in the future, very important consequences in the future. As a result, the power of the company was also reduced considerably after the fifth report when it was submitted in the British Parliament.